For the romantic artist, the business of creation was not something to be undertaken lightly. In this romantic credo, Victor Hugo, the great French novelist, dramatist, poet, thinker, painter, exhorts the playwright to create drama out of his own blood, sweat and tears, out of his own life experience. The poet quivers. Alive inside his own creation, it is he. In tears, he tears out his insides, then puts them into his drama. The sculptor, alone on his black mountain top, kneads his own flesh into the hallowed clay. From it, he is forever reborn. The dreamer creates Othello from a tear, Alceste from a sob, flourishes within his creation, inseparable from those he shapes. In his true and immense creative act, unique and manifold, the artist, suffering from an eternal wound, gives himself without destroying his flesh. Radiance streams forth. This dramatic urgency and the poetic intimacy that demanded by Hugo seems normal to us in an age where the lives of poets are better known than their poems, even though the poems tell the lives. All modern poetry is, in a sense, romantic. It's autobiography, accounts of suffering, confessions. But in the early 19th century, when the romantic playwrights led by Victor Hugo first appeared on the scene, mainstream poetry and drama was created by the poet, not of him. For instance, it did not reflect his own experience of life. It was Hamlet who first inspired the romantic revolution of the theatre, and it was Shakespeare, 200 years after his death, who became the father to the new drama. In the autumn of 1827, an English theatre group arrived in Paris to perform 5 Shakespeare plays. They had pluck. Only 5 years earlier, an English troupe had been hooted off the Parisian stage with cries of "Speak French!" This time, however, the enthusiastic audience was a veritable romantic roll call. As well as Victor Hugo, there was the painter Eugène Delacroix, and the novelist Alexandre Dumas, the composer Hector Berlioz. It was a period when the French theatre was dominated by worn-out productions of 18th century writers like Corneille and Racine. A play was expected to observe the rules, chief amongst which was the tyranny of the three unities: unity of time, unity of place, and unity of action. Character had to be royal, with lots of kings and queens, the further removed from the present, the better. Comic elements were out, and the language was set like aspic in Alexandrian verse, which ensured that it was suitably lofty, timeless, and remote from life as it was lived. No wonder then that Shakespeare came as a revelation. Shakespeare, who at the center of a great tragedy switches action from palace to graveyard and offers a comic scene between gravediggers. The romantic playwrights, led by Hugo, wrung their poetry out of their hearts, creating tragic and doomed romantic heroes like Werther, Faust, Manfred, Don Juan. Today, the greater part of romantic drama seems quaintly melodramatic, overloaded with snarling villains, damsels in distress, declamatory heroes. At the time, the startling events that took place on the romantic stage were the dress rehearsal for the romantic revolution. The bourgeoisie, the establishment, was outraged, but the romantics saw, understood, and felt.
Laurels, sacred bough that one wants to turn to dust, you who shelter his head from the lightning, will you abandon him to the infamous knife that makes the wicked fall under the hand of the executioner? Romans, will you suffer that one sacrifices one of your men, without whom Rome today would cease to be Rome? Say to us, Valere, if you want him to perish, where will you choose the setting for his punishment? Will it be here within these walls that echo with 1,000 voices the sounds of his victories?
For nearly 3 centuries, Rome and Greece ruled the dramatic theater. The stage was a palace of columns, helmets, white tunics, and golden armor. Playwrights sought in ancient Greece and Rome the dignity and intensity required for tragedy. In our own century, the doomed French playwright who founded the so-called Theatre of Cruelty, Antonin Artaud, echoes the feelings of the new generation of playwrights in the early 1800s. Faced by the fossilized speeches and gestures of the classical theatre.
The masterpieces of the past are good for the past. They are not good for us. We have the right to say what has been said and even that which has not been said in a way that belongs to us, that in a way is immediate, direct, that corresponds to present ways of feeling, and that everyone will understand.
In the France of 1820, to the generation conceived in the Revolution, to the survivors of the Napoleonic Wars, the helmets and tunics and dramatic formulae laid down by Aristotle don't seem very relevant. Drama cut off from its audience, at any rate from its rightful audience, drama cut off from the social and political community, is denounced by them as dead drama. The Romantic rebels reject the ancient worlds of Greece and Rome, the worlds inhabited by the aging Corneille and Racine. They want a living theatre. Romantic theatre is a hurricane of enthusiasms and passions, longings and illusions carried away in ecstatic movement. In this frenzied quest for immediacy and spontaneity, it is poetry which gives meaning and purpose. It is the poetry which sustains the heightened energy of the soul and contains the romantic overflow of feeling.
Poetry is the lava of the imagination. The eruption prevents an earthquake.
Byron creates The Corsair, written con amore and much from existence. The lonely and mysterious Corsair embodies the passions and ideals of his age. Ferocious and solitary, he is driven by the inner way of passions, fierce and deep. For the Corsair, there is no repentance, no remorse, no forgiveness. He is the renegade who does not wish for paradise, but for rest. Betrayed by society, he declares war on society, war fought with the violence of disgust. The hero villain seeks escape, escape from the boredom of life.